Welcome back to Reading Bear.
Today, we will take a look at some new entitled parent stories.
And if you enjoyed my content, please don't forget to subscribe to my channel and post some bear emojis in the comments. Let's go!
The first one is titled, Entitled Mum and Son Eat Poisonous Berries, Despite My Warning Signs. So background, I live in Southern California, very close to the beach. Needless to say that I encounter a lot of locals and tourists. On the right side of my property across the street, there are shops, a cafe, and a bus stop. Now on my property, I have a hollyberry bush, which are poisonous. Now they taste like cherries and have a cinnamon-like aftertaste, so a person that doesn't know about the plant would have no idea of this. The side effects of the berries are nausea, disorientation, diarrhea, vomiting, and severe stomach cramps. Due to my house being on the historic registry and nature protection laws, I can't just remove the bush because some of the birds pick at it and eat from it. I know that the berries and leaves aren't poisonous to some species of birds and other critters like certain squirrels and chipmunks. Anyway, because of this, I have two signs that say, do not eat, and danger. The fact that I have a sign with danger, with a hazard skull and bones, deters most people, except for this persistent mum and boy last morning. So, it's around 10:30 and I take my trash out. This mum, who looked about 40, had two kids with her, a teen girl around 14 to 16 maybe, and a little boy who looked 6 to 8 years old. The mum and the boy are the entitled, stupid ones here. The teen girl was actually nice. The boy says, entitled boy, mum, look, berries. Entitled mum, wow, I didn't realize berries grew here, let's get some. I ask her to read the signs that say don't eat them. She scoffs and says, entitled mum, ugh, it's not like you need all these berries. You should be nice and give them to my kids, don't be greedy. Entitled boy, mum, when are we going to have berries? Entitled mum, right now. Teen girl, you want any? Teen girl, no mum, I think they're cut off by the mum. Entitled mum, okay then. Because I'm older, I couldn't run fast enough to catch them. The mum and son broke a branch off the berry bush, they started running and scarfing down berries and went to the bus stop across the street with the teen girl reluctantly following. I was yelling to get her attention for nearly 20 minutes. But after the mum and the boy started getting overly sweaty and acting weird, the teen came to talk to me. Teen girl, hey sir, what's wrong? Me, those berries are poisonous, I tried to warn your mother and brother, but it's too late. The teen started to cry, thinking that they were going to die. I comforted her, saying that they'll live, but they're going to be just very, very sick. Soon I went to my house to get seltzer tablets and water bottles to help. But the time I came back, both the mum and son finished all the berries and the boy threw up all over his shirt. The mum came back with obvious signs of throwing up herself and to yell at me when I pointed to the signs that said danger and do not eat and that this was her fault. She flipped the bird and left, the teen just said sorry. I gave her the seltzer tablets and she went into the cafe to get paper towels to clean up her brother, but by the time she came back, the mum vomited too. They all got on the bus and I haven't seen them since. Thanks for reading, have a great day. Edit, there's been a lot of people asking me about the berries and my house. So I bought my house 50 years ago and I didn't know that the berries were poisonous. Despite me having signs and warning people for all these years, people still managed to eat them, and yes, many people have gotten sick. But due to my house being on the historic registry, I can't remove the bush. So I have to do the best that I can do, warn others, but people still eat them. The next one is titled, Karen Tries to Ruin a Cancer Patient's Make-A-Wish Day So Her Child Won't Be Inconvenienced, Saw the Absolute End All Be All last week. I work for a small production company and we do a ton of charitable work. That day, a few of our crew members, myself included, were lent out for a make-a-wish type thing for a girl whose wish was to have her original song made into a music video. She was battling cancer, so, of course, every precaution had to be taken, COVID-wise. The director reserved a scenic section of the park and got all set up there so we could be outdoors with plenty of distance. Apparently, this was the only section of the park with a picnic area. We weren't aware of this, and occasionally some people would come over pretty miffed asking why we'd reserved the whole picnic area, but before they could get the whole complaint out, they'd realize the situation and leave us be, embarrassed to even have asked. This young lady was around 14 or 15 and having a great time shooting these scenes for her music video. Until, Karen, a mess of cheap Botox and overpriced athleisure gear, started crossing over our clearly marked barricades with her daughter, around 6 or 7. Our PA, production assistant, rushed over, figuring she was just too dumb to notice all of our signage and physical blockades, and explained in a hushed tone that she was intruding on a private film set. Karen replied, intentionally loudly, that it was a public park and she had every right to use any part of it she pleased. Now, was it a tad bit inconvenient that we'd commandeered a large strip of public land, the only area with seating? Absolutely. But the handful of people who'd wander over to complain immediately processed the nature of this project and gladly made other plans for themselves. Karen wasn't budging, but we had a permit from the city to be there, so we let her know she could quiet down or shove off. We actually had a right to have her ejected if she was being disruptive to our filming. We really didn't want to though, and we didn't exactly have the manpower to do it without calling authorities, and we didn't want to put a damper on this fun event or make a scene in front of her daughter, so the director paused filming to try and de-escalate things. There was supposed to be a liaison from the Make-A-Wish style program there, but the catering guy had gotten lost on the way to the park and she'd gone to go look for him. So, the director showed Karen the permit we had and warned her a final time she either needed to watch calmly or get out of there. She pulled her young daughter off to the side and started trying to goad her into singing. The kid was better able to read the room than mum, because she was too embarrassed to start singing, and tried saying she wanted to wait until she got home, but Karen kept pointing her phone camera at the kid and shrieking she wanted her to sing there and then so she could film it. Eventually she started playing some Disney song on from her phone and the kid began hissing along, interrupting out our footage, much to Karen's twisted satisfaction. Finally the director had it and informed her that even though she had technically moved off of the land we'd physically reserved, that the noise she and her daughter were generating was disruptive so he could still have her removed. Not even sure this is true, but I think he just correctly assumed that, hello, 911? This woman is harassing a young girl with cancer trying to experience her Make-A-Wish day, wouldn't end in Karen's favor. But Karen's pride wouldn't allow her to simply walk away from the situation, so once her daughter had ceased this loud off-key singing, she continued lingering even as her child begged her to go play by a pond almost a quarter of a mile over. Karen continually tried to force her daughter into the shot, with hopes it would make us to move, cruelly getting her kids' hopes up and dashing them repeatedly, so I guess the kid wasn't especially bright either. She'd keep saying, "Look baby, they're making a movie. Quick, go be in the movie so you can get famous. Hurry." And the girl would run onto our set, or try to, and a PA or the key grip would return her to her mum before she could run across our shot. But her daughter's anguished cries of disappointment at not becoming famous each time we returned her to her mum were enough to render most of the footage, if not useless, at least a lot less fun than it was intended to be. I guess Karen didn't think we heard her goading her child into disrupting us with fake promises of superstardom, because when the director came over for her final warning she tried to play dumb, saying, "Oh, I think she's just dead set on using the picnic space." Since this is the only picnic space in the entire park, it would probably just be easier for you to move, huh? Said with a combination of faux sweetness and imagined authority. Clearly she had no idea what it takes to set up for a film if she thought we could just move locations on a whim. The director turned out to be bluffing on calling the cops because he didn't want to create a scene until the liaison returned, so he just had a couple big crew guys keep her and her daughter at bay. Eventually the liaison did come back, but honestly, she wasn't particularly helpful. Karen deduced that she was who in charge and who everyone was waiting for in order to take action, so magically shaped up the minute she appeared and stood quietly to the side. So, when every crew member descended on the liaison at once, she just meekly said, "Well, it's fine if she watches, right? People are probably just curious what's going on." Thankfully the girl in the video had been having her makeup done for most of this while we filmed a backup dancer scene, so didn't really notice most of the debacle and didn't care one way or another. Because Karen had a little kid with her, the girl didn't say she couldn't watch, even though she was visibly uncomfortable at the strange audience. She kept waving to and winking at the little girl though, who thought she was some kind of celebrity. It was actually pretty cute, and a perfect compliment to her music video Make-A-Wish. Karen hated that and kept muttering to passers-by, trying to surmount insurrection. But, unbeknownst to her, just about everyone in the general area was affiliated with our shoot. She did manage to find one or two people who were irritated about the picnic area being closed, thinking we were just some greedy private party who'd sectioned it off from other guests. But then they realized it was some kind of film production and started milling around out of idle curiosity. Again, we were mostly filming backup dancers at this point, a couple of the girls' friends, so I give credit to Karen that if she wasn't paying a lot of close attention to the filming itself, it may not have been immediately obvious what exactly we were doing at that point. That still doesn't make what she did next okay. She'd make the occasional comment to the other picnic people and was winning some of them over. She'd say something like, "But do they need the entire space?" and get an affirmative nod. Whatever. I don't think the other people were really listening that closely. They were watching too intently, waiting for someone famous to pop out in the music video. Our tech people had determined that it wasn't interfering with the audio, so we had begun to ignore her also as long as she stayed out of the way. Then the star girl comes out for her big emotional dance scene and she's really giving it her all. So Karen decides to throw in another blow by turning to woman nearest her and saying, again, loud enough for everyone to hear, "Oh God, look, it's one of those girls who thinks it's cool to pretend to be a boy. I'll be she hasn't stopped to consider how long it will take to grow her hair back." You'd think Karen would have stopped for a second to consider that maybe the girl was not cultivating a chic new look and in fact had cancer. Or, better yet, that maybe a stranger's hairstyle wasn't her business in any case. And maybe her not having eyebrows or arm hair, either, was a clue. But nope. So, our poor starring girl hears this and crumples up into tears, now assuming that the crowds who had been gathering throughout the day were not doing so because they thought she was some famous pop star, but instead to gawk because she was strange looking. She rushed away and those standing anywhere near Karen hurried off to make clear they weren't associated with her. That's when the liaison realized what we had been trying to warn her about with Karen's behavior and tore into her along with several members of the girl's extended family. Like a true coward, Karen didn't even try to apologize, she just bolted as quickly as she could saying, "You know, maybe we'll find a different spot, since you're clearly busy." As though she were doing us a special consideration. Luckily our lead girl's entire extended family was there and cheered her up very quickly, and some supportive civilians had showed up with genuine curiosity about the film set, then loved watching her dance for no other reason than that they loved watching her dance. So she was happy and having fun again very quickly after Karen skulked off. But, still, really quite a hurtful and inappropriate spectacle. If she gets this worked up over a picnic table, I can only imagine when her daughter starts to face life's real challenges. The next one is titled, "My Entitled Grandma Thinks She Have the Right to Enter the House Without Permission, and Gets Mad When She Caught Me Pleasuring Myself." My grandma has a spare key to my parents' house, she has had it since me and my sister was little so she could come babysit us when our mum worked evenings. She doesn't need the key anymore since me and my sister are adults now and has moved out, I guess my parents forgot about it. So I've been visiting my parents over the summer and on two occasions my grandma showed up at the house unannounced when I was the only one home. She didn't knock, she just unlocked the door and walked straight in and went into my room, also without knocking. The first time she snuck up on me while gaming and scared the crap out of me. Fast forward like a week. I was once again home alone, my parents were away shopping or something, and I went to my room for some alone time, so to speak. There I was doing my deed, when I suddenly thought I heard something, so I stopped for a short while and listened, but I didn't hear any more so I continued with the deed. A minute later someone rips the door open, it was my grandma, and there I was, fully erected dick in my hand and porn on my phone. She looked shocked like she's just seen a ghost, then she closed the door and walked away and I could hear her from the kitchen saying something like, "Stop that. Get dressed and come here you little perv." I did as she said and dressed and got out to speak with her. She was mad and the conversation went like this, "Gee, grandma, I'm so sorry. But you can't walk in like that. Gee, I have the key. And you wasn't opening when I knocked because you're in your room perving yourself, don't know how to translate it into English, snuska sig in Swedish. But you can't come as you want without permission, it's not your house. Gee, it's not your house either, it's my daughter's, aka my mum, and I can do whatever I want. No you don't? Why do you even still have the key? Gee, that's beyond the point young man. Yes she called me that, why are you in there and committing blasphemy, again translation, you should stop that sick behavior and focus on getting married, I'm 25, never even had a girlfriend, and she's always bugging me about getting married. And also I'm gonna press charges for sexual harassment. You exposed yourself for me. That's illegal. And I'm gonna press charges for trespassing. I'm just gonna show to security footage from the front door camera. And by the way I can do what I want with my own body in my free time. Gee, no you can't. That's sick and disgusting. I'm gonna tell your mum that you exposed yourself for me. So you mean that you're gonna speak to my manager? Ironic, gee, no. I said your mum. You bet she's gonna ground you for this. Laughter you that I don't live here, and I'm 25. And I don't think my mum would care anyways after I show her the front door footage of you walking in without knocking. Gee, whatever. You're still in big problems, you nasty pervert. Then she stormed out and slammed the door. And I saw her messing with something by the door, probably tried to reach the front door camera, and I later saw on the footage her trying to jump for the camera, kind of a funny sight seeing a 155cm, 70-year-old lady jumping and punching for something out of reach. And I also saw her walking in without knocking and unlocking the door, it was the first thing she did when she got to the door. I called my mum after she'd left and told her this story. I didn't tell her about the special business, of course. I said that I was changing clothes and happened to be naked when grandma opened the door. My mum laughed and said that she's gonna take the spare key back, or change locks. I still don't know if my grandma has talked to my mum yet after the incident since it happened fairly recently. I've went back to my apartment since this happened, so I'm kind of curious about what my mum would ground me from, leaving my own apartment maybe. I will update if I hear anything more about this. Update comes right away. I wrote this story a while ago, new on Reddit, and didn't know about needing karma to post here. My grandma called my mum the next day and yelled at her for raising such a pervert of a son. She actually lied about the what happened and said that was walking around naked and that I answered the door and started to perv myself, which is her way of describing pleasuring yourself, in front of her, and that I scared her for life and she thought that I was about to attack her sexually and all kinds of made up bullpoop. She said that I'm going to jail for this and that I'm probably a vapist in disguise. My mum laughed at her at first and said that doesn't sound like anything Todderman, me, would do, and why would he do such a thing in front of his own grandma. She said that she's just lying and that I told her the truth and that her claims are ridiculous. My mum was also kind of pissed that she called me a potential rapist, but she didn't see any point in arguing about it because my grandma always thinks she's in the right no matter what you tell her. My mum will probably only change the locks and don't say anything to her. Getting the spare key back is probably impossible considering how my grandma is. My mum simply said that I shouldn't care about what that stupid witch says and that I shouldn't worry about her pressing charges. She wouldn't do that, she just uses that as a threat, and if she were to, she would have no evidence, and also I have evidence of her walking in without knocking, so I'm not that concerned about that. The next one is titled, My M Was Afraid of Doctors and I Nearly Died from a Muscle Cramp. My mother, the M of our tale, grew up in a household that didn't believe in doctors or going to the hospital. This translated to an irrational fear of hospitals for my M. At the time of this story I was 14, in high school, and about to have a very bad day. I should start by saying that my M lives exactly 1 mile away from the closest emergency room. Also, my siblings and father were out of town for a competition that weekend. I didn't feel like going to another cheerleading competition, so I stayed home. I get home from school on a Friday around 4 p.m. and call M to tell her that I don't feel good and think I need to see a doctor. M says that she has a 1-hour workout with her personal trainer, PT, who happens to train the whole family for our sports teams. M tells me that she will come home right after and take me to the pediatrician. 4:40 p.m. I call M saying that something is seriously wrong with me and I really think I need to go to the hospital. She tells me that PT just had a cancellation and she is staying for another hour workout, then she will take me to the doctor. 5:10 p.m. I call M and beg her to come home because I'm in a lot of pain and feel terrible. She gives the phone over to PT, who says, I poop you not, it sounds like a muscle cramp from our workout last week, you'll be fine buddy. She says she will call our friendly neighbor, FN, across the street to check on me. 10 minutes later I hear FN walk in through the door and come to my room to check me out. I'm on the floor because I fell after going to the bathroom and couldn't get up. She helps me into bed and immediately calls M. Convo goes something like this: FN, hey M, I think you need to get here ASAP. Your son is white as a sheet and sweating bullets. Also, he is in so much pain he can barely move. M, oh, I'm sure he is fine, probably just overreacting from a muscle cramp like PT says. FN, this isn't just a muscle cramp. He needs to see a doctor. I can put him in my car and meet you at hospital ER that is only 1 mile away. M, no need for that, I'll finish up here and head home to take him to the doctor. Click 5:45 p.m. FN calls M again and M says she is in changing room then will be home in 10 minutes. Gym is pretty close. 6:20 p.m. M finally gets home. FN tells her what I've been going through and says I need to go to the ER. M says she is taking me to see our pediatrician. M does take me to see our pediatrician, who also runs a pediatric ER. The problem is that doctor's office is 25 minutes drive away with zero traffic, and we are at the arse end of rush hour. 7:15-ish p.m. we get to the pediatric ER and they immediately take me into the back to see what's wrong. Turns out I have an acute appendicitis and it's close to bursting, so they need to send me over to hospital 1 mile from my house to get it removed. The entire time my M is murmuring about needing to get ready for a trial the next day, she's a divorce lawyer, and how I'll probably be fine and just need to sleep it off. Then there comes a moment when M is out of the room but I have a doctor and nurse in the room alone with me. I tell them the whole story about how I've been trying to get her to take me to the ER since 4, how we lived only a mile away from the hospital they wanted to send me but my M decided to go here because she hates big hospitals. The doctor didn't really believe me until I told him to MapQuest, old school I know, my address relative to the hospital. I managed to convince them to call for an ambulance to transport me to the hospital to make sure I got there. After my surgery, the nurse told me that my appendix burst as they began the surgery, so they had to be quick. To this day, I still tease PT every time I see him by grabbing my side and saying I think I have a muscle cramp. I've never heard him use those words together since. The last one is entitled Mother Became Enraged Because Our Food Program was cancelled. That food program was the charity of a teacher who passed away. Context: this woman has been a problem parent at the center for as long as her 5-year-old child, Molly, has been here. The girl started as an infant in our baby room, so that's 5 years of this woman. This M is not a good person. She would not pack lunches for her daughter, she would often send her then 13-year-old to bring Molly into the daycare because she didn't want to, and at least 3 times a week, teachers had to give the child a bath in the sink, and when she was too big for that, a sponge bath because she smelled so bad. Yes, we called CPS, and I'm not sure what came of that, but I know Molly is still in her custody. It was awful, but there was one saving grace this girl could look to, Jenny. Jenny was the sweetest woman you would ever meet. She worked in one of the preschool classrooms, but her heart was so big and open that she extended her kindness to all children. Every time Molly came in without a lunch, Jenny would make sure she had food, even if it meant driving to the local Walmart or country fair to get her a sandwich. Eventually, Jenny began to bring in food personally for Molly, because Molly's M never packed her lunch. Jenny died suddenly and unexpectedly in 2019. She was young, just barely over 30. M kept bringing Molly in without lunches, and up until COVID hit, it was an ongoing battle that finally came to a head yesterday. Molly came in at 10:30 yesterday, which was too late for breakfast. In the preschool classrooms, we keep them on a schedule, and breakfast ends at 8:30, while they get snack at 10 o'clock. Molly had snack, and lunch started at noon. When the teacher opened her lunchbox to prep her food at lunch, she noticed there was breakfast in there. She decided, politely, to remind Molly's mother that breakfast ends at 8:30, and if she was planning to bring in her in later, to please have her eat before she comes in, because things are already in full swing in the classroom. This was done via a childcare app that we use to communicate with parents. Well, M did not like that, and called the center screaming at our assistant director, AD. This lasted for 10 minutes, and the pregnant AD came into my room, the infant room, angry about all this. She cooled down, and went back to her office. The offices are right next to my room, so I was being somewhat nosy and listening in. M came to pick Molly up, effectively pulling her from the center. There, she got to shouting at the AD, "Wouldn't you be upset if they weren't feeding your baby? Wouldn't you want justice and people held accountable?" That's when the director, D, stepped in and told the AD to check on the other classrooms. Translation: you don't have to fucking listen to this, I'll handle it. D then followed up with, "Personally, I would make sure that my child ate breakfast before bringing her in." AD left at that point. M was throwing a fit about how she didn't like the teachers here, how she thought Diana, the preschool teacher for the 4/5-year-olds, was a raging bitch, and how she didn't like her since the beginning, and how a lot of parents pulled their kids because of her. Thing is, she was confusing Tiana with Tessa, the younger preschool teacher for the 3/4-year-olds. Tessa is, admittedly, a strict woman, but her strictness was countered with kindness and positive reinforcement. Em is so out of touch with her daughter's providers that she never even got to meet Tiana. Finally, she delivered the zinger everyone knew was coming, but hopes she had enough class to refrain from saying, "You stopped doing the food program when Jenny died. I think you are just too selfish and cheap to honor her memory in continuing it." To which Dee finally stood up and said Jenny was the food program. She bought that food for Molly out of her own pocket, with her money that she earned caring for the children here. The reason this so-called food program stopped was because Jenny died. To which M doubled down and said, "Well, why wouldn't you continue to buy food for the children in her honor?" D, "Because we do not have the budget to allocate funds for a food program, and in addition, in our handbook, it states we are only to provide snacks. We would need a whole other set of clearances and regulations to start serving food here like a cafeteria." M, "But you did it when Jenny was here." The argument continued back and forth like that until finally, Dee basically said that this was the second outburst that M had, and that they could no longer accept Molly at the center with this continued behavior. M, needing to get the last word in, finished with, "Fine. I don't want to send my child to a place that starves her." Then she left with Molly. "My heart breaks for the child, but there's not much else to do. I just can't believe how classless you have to be, in one argument, to bring up a beloved, saintly person like Jenny and then basically insinuate that our wonderful AD was going to be a bad mother, while acting like we are still somehow the assholes for cancelling our non-existent food program. Edit, wanted to say a few things because apparently I wasn't clear enough. First, Molly had both breakfast and lunch in her lunchbox. Tiana assumed she ate breakfast at home since she came in at 10 o'clock, so didn't know there was breakfast in her lunchbox. Molly had, and ate, lunch that day. Breakfast was sent home. Second, CPS was called when Molly was an infant and when she was 2 or 3, I can't remember exactly, as I did not make the call. Both times, nothing came of it, however, Molly was clean coming in and her mother is, begrudgingly, packing her lunches. Third, a lot of wanting me to contact CPS a third time. I, personally, do not have the information available to make a proper report, full name, address, legal guardian, updated phone number, things like that. I can, however, talk to Tiana, whom was her teacher. I know Tiana was considering calling CPS again, but she didn't disclose the reason to me. Tiana has a lot more info and insight on this situation than me. I teach in an entirely separate classroom and only got this story because it was so public, and of course, considering she was yelling at the pregnant AD, who wouldn't want to know why? I will update this again if I get confirmation on what Tiana plans to do. Edit 2, AD ended up calling the police because M was blowing up our messaging app for our daycare, calling Tiana all sorts of horrible names and talking crazy. Some threats were made towards the AD, so Tiana told her and the AD is considering filing a restraining order if things continue to escalate. She threatened to dox the center. Our center's contact info is online, so I DK if it's a dox, but that's what she basically threatened to do. CPS was contacted. This woman has a record, and I'm pretty sure half the threats she made could get her in a lot of trouble. A metric ducton happened this weekend. I cannot even. This might be the last edit. I'm not comfortable sharing much more because this is escalating way too quickly and I want to make sure things are in control before I update again.